Hello, film students. We're going to be talking about a scene from Strangers on a Train today. We're going to be looking at the tennis scene near the end of the movie and how Hitchcock maintains excitement in this scene, even though it feels like tennis is totally beside the point at this point in the movie. So, what you need to do for this activity is just take notes on what we are saying. Make sure your notes are thorough. You want to have enough information there that I can tell that you watched this video and that I can tell that you had some of your own thoughts during watching this video. So if you go on a little bit of a tangent and something I say makes you think of something else that you noticed from the movie, write that down as well because I'm looking for you actually engaging with this content. That's the whole point of you taking notes on the videos. Okay, so this scene happens at an hour and 15 minutes into the movie. Anne has just talked to Bruno and has realized what his plan is going to be. He's going to go take the lighter to the island where he killed Miriam, and he's going to drop this lighter there as evidence for the police. And so she is very anxious about her husband-to-be, being accused of this crime, right? And her husband-to-be is this tennis pro, and he needs to play this match right now. And one way that Hitchcock begins to build excitement for this scene is at this table scene where Anne and Guy are talking about the stakes. So we're just going to watch a minute or so of this.
Said if the police ever found your lighter there, that's all they'd need. Something to prove that you were at the scene of the murder.
That lie about my wanting him to get it back means he's going to put my lighter on that island.
Guy, I wanted to help, but I'm afraid all I did is make things worse. My going there right after you did only made him more furious than ever.
No, darling. He said last night he'd think of something.
2015.
He certainly has.
Guy, you've got to get to Medcalf before he does. You haven't time to play. You better tell.
If that loudspeaker announces I'm not going to play, Hennessy's bound to be suspicious. He'll keep me from ever getting near Metcalf.
Well, then I'll go.
No way. You stay right here and help me give Hennessy the slip after the match.
But darling, that'll be too late.
Didn't Bruno say I wanted him to go there one night after dark?
Yes.
But that's what's in his mind now. He's not going to expose himself in broad daylight. If I can finish off the match in 3 sets,
Guy,
I still have to...
Around in a few minutes, Guy. How are you, Miss Martin?
Okay, so in this scene, you can see how Hitchcock has used that time-honored trick of tension that we have talked about a few times now, which is setting a timer on events. He gives a pretty reasonable explanation for why a guy can't skip out on the tennis match altogether. And then he says, like, here are the stakes, here is the timing for things, and here is the ultimate motivation to ending this tennis match as quickly as possible. So the longer the tennis match goes, the more our tensions rise. I'm going to say just maybe I'm wrong, but I think that tennis is a boring sport. I think that it's like dull to watch two people hit a ball back and forth. I don't really like sports in general, so maybe I'm not one to talk. I don't really like have I don't really have like experience with being excited by any kind of sport, but tennis in particular feels boring to me because of the repetition of it. So what Hitchcock needs to do here is he needs to show why it is important that we watch this whole tennis match. Because this next scene, it's about 10 minutes long. We're going to see Guy playing. It's essentially it's sped up and it's cut, but what is essentially an entire tennis match. And we are thinking about murder the whole time, and so we don't really care who wins or who loses. And that's really actually important for this scene. Hitchcock sets it up so that, like, there are no stakes about who wins the match. If Guy can lose quickly, then he could move on that way too. But whatever he does, he can't raise suspicion, and he is a champion, and so he has to play kind of like the normal way that he plays. So then that gives us the opportunity for watching tennis. It starts about here. So let's just watch a little bit of this so that you can see other ways, other tricks that Hitchcock is using to make the match exciting.
Hey, 3:15.
Okay, a couple tricks there. He is varying shot distance. So sometimes he goes closer, sometimes he goes further away. He's also playing a little bit with angles. So sometimes he's high up, like we see here, and sometimes he's at eye level, and then sometimes he's even low. Did you catch that shot where the tennis ball is actually coming straight for the camera? That's ways of maintaining visual interest in this scene. When you watch tennis on TV, especially maybe from a few years ago, I think since I stopped having television, they have some ways of making the camera seem closer. Like, they have ways of building up that visual interest, the same they do with like football and basketball now. But if you had watched tennis in the 90s, like I did, it basically stays at the exact same distance the entire time. And they would have those cuts between the two. What's called continuity editing is what that is, where it looks like the action is continuous. And they'd have the camera on one side and the camera on the other so that they kind of cut it together so that you get closer views of the people as they, you know, hit the ball. I'm going to have no tennis terminology here. But basically that was it for viewing tennis on television in real life. But in a film, obviously, it doesn't have to be continuous. Like, you don't have to be filming the whole time. So you could set up the camera and have Guy do all of his different shots from different angles and then just splice it together. Movie magic, right? So this helps maintain our interest. The other thing that you saw in that scene were the cutaways. And cutaways are great for creating tension in a sports scene. So basically, a cutaway edit is where you cut to somebody who is outside the main action of the screen. So you have continuity editing for the main action as the ball goes back and forth. And then you have these cutaways to look at Anne and, oh, I'm always forgetting that girl's name, but it's Pat Hitchcock. It's Hitchcock's daughter is playing the girl with the glasses. Anyway, those cutaways show this tension. We are kind of sutured into Anne's perspective here. We feel like outsiders and a little bit out of control. And so by showing that look on her face, that out of control look on her face and that anxiety, it builds the anxiety in us. There's another thing that he does to create tension in this scene. Let's see if we can catch it. Just a lot of tennis for a while. Go. You see that shot that looks at the clock, right? Anytime you look at the clock, you are reminded that there's a time restriction on this activity. And he is not the only one who looks at his clock. Bruno does as well. I'm going to pause my video here and find the right scene. In this scene, you're going to see a new style of editing. It's called parallel editing, or sometimes you'll hear it called cross-cutting. Basically, what it means is that there are two actions happening at once, but in totally different spaces. So you have Bruno that is back in that town with the fair, and you have Guy here on the tennis court, but it's going to cut between them and show that these things are happening at the same time. This was not something that filmmakers were able to take for granted. They didn't know that audiences would be able to follow this kind of editing until about the 19-teens, when a very famous director named D.W. Griffith showed how cross-cutting could work. And somehow our brains are able to see these things as existing as parallel in time, even though they are in very different locations. And one of the ways that directors make sure that we know that that is what is going on is these visual cues, these visual echoes. So you're going to see how Guy looks at a clock, and then Bruno is going to look at his watch. Let's watch it.
2-1. Guy Haynes leading, and we're 10-all in the fourth.
All right, what you're going to notice there, so you saw the clock thing. That's another way of building tension and another way of connecting these two scenes together. Now I want you to watch for shot duration. In the tennis match, things are speeding up. We know that it's nearing the end of the match. And pretty soon, Anne is going to need to create this distraction so that Guy can escape. So it's like the tension is starting to mount. In the other scene, you'll notice how the tension mounts, but in a different kind of way. And this is two different ways to build tension. And by cross-cutting between the two, you kind of compound the effect. So let's watch this scene. Again, watch for shot duration, like the length of time before they edit.
Fourth set. This match, from a quick victory for Haynes, has turned into a dogfight. There you go.
Down there. My cigarette case. It's very valuable.
Down here?
Yes, you've got to get that grating up right away.
What's the trouble?
Well, can't we do something? I dropped my cigarette case.
Mightn't be any good, mister. Probably gone down a storm drain.
Storm drain?
On the other hand, maybe it lodges on the edge.
Don't they have a trap down there, like under a sink, you know?
Well, don't just stand here. Do something.
I guess we could phone the city engineer, all right. Worst he could do would be to tell me to go take a run and
jump. Now, look, mister.
Relax, mister.
I don't want to relax.
All right, did you notice there how both shots were long? The Bruno scene is longer because it has all that dialogue in it, but the tennis scene too, they didn't cut for that little section of the match. It just shows it going back and the ball going back and forth without any sort of editing. And then it cuts to Bruno, and that is also a very long shot. Now see what happens as the match continues and the struggle for the lighter continues.
He's grim and determined, and he needs but one more game for the entire match.
You can keep watching that if you want. It just gets more intense. I have to be careful because at 15 minutes, this program shuts me down. Basically, you have the action, you notice this, speeding up in the tennis scene, edits coming at you really, really quickly, and then action slowing down in that lighter scene. Both create tension. The slowness creates a kind of tension because we're like reaching for it with him, and the quickness creates this kind of tension because we're feeling the emotions and the adrenaline starting to ramp up. So watch the next video for my wrap up of this.